It's a joy and a privilege to be sharing the Word of God and ministering to you in the Philadelphia Revival Church. I had the privilege of visiting one of our friends who's pastoring in India, Kerala. And I would like to share a bit about some of my experience which I had. I want to thank Pastor George and Pastor Thomas George for leading the English worship, Malayalam worship. It's a joy in the days to come. But you will grow. Amen. And I'm glad that God has appointed great men. And the Lord loves the church. And you're a great people. I hope you're all doing well. As we are worshiping, there is something I want you to know which came to my heart, which I want to share with you. Look, whatever happens to you, it's for good. Anything that happens to the children of God, good or bad, it's for good. Our Heavenly Father is an amazing way of changing things. I wish some of you knew him as I knew him. The devil has tried, people have tried, evil people have tried to destroy me and my life many times. The Lord looks at all that from heaven, laughs. He changes a couple of things. We come out victorious. I want you to have this confidence about your Heavenly Father. He is an amazing God. I will never give him up for anything in the world. Church, I want you to know, yesterday, my wife and I, we were holding hands, and we're just thanking the Lord for this church. Not because we had something to do with it. You do not know how valuable you are. I was listening to some of the stories that happens in the churches of God. The kind of cheap, dirty politics people play for the pulpit or for the chair or whatever. And the hearts that are wounded. People who are offended. It's a sad story outside there. And I said, Lord, just thank you for the Philadelphia Revival. I mean it. I really mean it. If you like to, you can tell your neighbor, I really value this church. I value this. As a member of this church, my family and I, we really value this church. We may have been used, but we are used by the Lord to pioneer this church, I know. But more than all that we do as a minister, we love to be members of this church. I mean it from the depth of my heart. I thank my God with all my heart. You don't know how precious you are. Honestly, some of the places you go, people sit as though they're going to devour you. Make you feel sorry that you ever walked into there. You know, but I thank God for you, wonderful people. You need to know, I'm going to tell you some of the experiences I had back in Kerala. The reason is not to show off. The reason is given in 1 John. If you will go there quickly, 1 John 1. We'll make a very short service today. 1 John 1, we want to stop at 1, including the word. So let's look into 1 John 1, where the apostle says a beautiful thing. He's sharing a lot of things with the church so that something may happen between them. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled of the word of life. He's talking about Jesus. Verse 2, for the life was manifested and we have seen it and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. Verse 3, that which we have seen and heard declare we to you so that you also may have fellowship with us. That means, when the man of God speaks the experiences he had from God, and when you receive it, you're having a spiritual fellowship. God is essentially interested in a spiritual fellowship with each one of us. The physical relationship is secondary to the spiritual fellowship. That is why Jesus said, if you want to follow me, hate your father, hate your mother, and take up the cross and follow me, and all those things, because he wants us to have a spiritual relationship. Amen. So what I'm going to tell you is something that we may have a spiritual relationship, because I saw how the Lord was working in a couple of places. Amen. You know, Pastor C.R. Suresh, who has come here, who was staying last time with Pastor Thomas George's house and Sister Mercy's house, and he was there for almost 90 days. And he has had a wonderful time. So his son was baptized by us, I would like to say that, when we were there last time. And his daughter was very adamant that, again, I should go and baptize her. So because he did not want to show any favoritism, he held on 3 or 4 baptisms and said, Pastor, you should come. I told him, you don't have to do all these things. Don't teach the people the wrong thing. You are the pastor. You have the right to, you know, whoever comes to you, it's your ministry, your hard work, your labor of love. When people come and baptize, don't wait for big superstars. He said, that's not the way it is, Pastor. But since I had to do it for my son, I have to do it for my daughter also. And he said one thing, he said, Pastor, it's not about honoring anybody or making anybody good. I just love the anointing on you. It's different. It is separate. It is not like other people. I said, all right, fine. If that's the way you respect the anointing, I value it. So it so happened that, I had an open ticket and there was an opportunity for me to go to Kerala. We just made use of it. If I didn't make use of that ticket may have been lost. So I used that ticket to just go there. I was there for 5 days and we were able to minister that baptism. But in the process, the last 3 days of their fasting prayer, they just completed their fasting prayer. We are starting ours, by the way, soon. By the way, Brother Charyan wants you to know that August 26th is our picnic. Please keep this day. We'll tell you more details. And also, we are entering into a long time of fasting and prayer. Morning and evening, we'll be having meetings here. Make it a point to come. Those who want to fast, we'll train you how to fast. And also, I would ask all the ministers, those who are ministering in the church, I would like to meet you one of these days, worship team, pastors, all of us, whoever is ministering in the church, we will be setting apart some time for ourselves. Okay, so those 3 days, they were having their fasting prayer, and I was there, and I saw the hunger people have for God. The hunger people have for God. There was a lady called Lena. She traveled all the way from Saudi Arabia. She's working there as a nurse. She was not sure if she will get a vacation. But she prayed and prayed and prayed. I think she even fasted and prayed for the ability to come to this fasting prayer. And finally, she got a 3-day, a 4-day. She took 3 or 4 days, spent all the money just to attend the fasting prayer. And the Lord healed her of her problems in thyroid. On the last day, she was so filled with God's Holy Spirit and things were really happening. God was there. Jesus was there. Hallelujah. And one of the things which the Lord showed me, which I want you to know, which is practical for you. We were all worshiping. The word was just delivered. We were all worshiping the Lord. But there was no movement. I found everybody was looking at me. Suddenly in the spirit of the Lord, I said, look not at a man, look at Jesus. The minute that word came out, the power and the presence of God came so much on the people of God. They could not stop worshiping. So powerful. I want to tell the church, if we also have a problem in looking at man more than Jesus, we need to come back and look at Jesus. He alone deserves to be glorified. It's one of the things I want to share with you. Let Jesus be the top person. Why are we coming to church? To see him, as Betsy said rightly, we come to see our Heavenly Father and to be in his presence. It is Jesus Christ that matters. And I want you to know something quickly. I have understood that a lot of churches, even Pentecostal churches, no offense to them, many people do not mention the name of Jesus. They all say God. The Hindus do that. The Muslims do that. Why don't you say the name of Jesus? More than anything, his name is everything. What a joy it is to declare his name in the presence of his people. How sad. He dies on the cross. God the Father lifts him up. And people just say, you know, Malayalam, Devathina Nadathipa. It is the Lord. Hindus can say God. Muslims say God. The word God only means authority. Our Jesus is greater than authority. Our Jesus Christ is our life. Here is miracle number 2. After that powerful meeting, there was this lady and her husband. They were descendants of atheists. Somebody told me later that this fellow's father was an atheist going around and telling people there is no God. And finally, his son and his daughter-in-law come for prayer. That's the way God works. So she has a problem. After the meeting, I ask her, what is your issue? Why are you worried? She said, I am afraid. I said, afraid for what? I know my mother had cancer. My sister has cancer. I am just waiting for it to come. I said, bad mindset. Very bad mindset. Now don't get offended. This is only to strengthen you. Don't be afraid and stop coming to church when I say this, some of you. We have nothing to fear. Amen. The Lord did an amazing thing there. She was set free. Totally free. She said, I know something left me, I'm free. I said, that fear is not from you. You will not have cancer. But the important thing, interesting thing which I want to share with you is this. Just after the ministry was over, I know the lady was set free after the meeting. Just like pastors come here and pray for you. I was praying for this lady. People were all waiting for prayer. People were moving up and down. Pastor Suresh was standing there, direct me to different people. This lady was seated right in front of the church and she was set free. I look back, I see my friend maybe 40 years back. I see my friend. His father is very famous in Kerala. He's known as Kallimala Kunjumon. A very, very, very popular man of God. He was, especially his teachings are about holiness and separation. I look around, I see my friend wearing a white kurta and a white pant and his wife wearing a white dress and all that. He was watching me doing all these things. Okay? As he was standing there, he was seeing me, he was seeing the Lord working through me. Nothing big about it, but as I was traveling, the Lord suddenly reminded me how 40 years ago, I was standing in his father's ministry and I was watching like a little child, maybe, you know, one of the 10-year-olds here or 12-year-olds here, you're a 10-year-old. I was watching in his father's ministry, his own dad casting out demons. It was a prophetic, complete clock around that he should watch me doing it. 40 years is a big number in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I was surprised. The Lord told me, see what happens. You are watching even without knowing. You did not know anything. You are watching a man of God, a powerfully anointed man of God doing something. Today I have lifted you to a level where you are easily doing these things. And their generation are watching you. That is a prophetic clock around. These things happen in the kingdom of God. Amen. Totally the presence of God. I was telling somebody here, I don't remember who it was, telling them, I have only seen, this is not to lift me up, in my ministry, I have not seen this kind of a presence so far. My God, you should start praying. Revival Church, we should not go back. To the best of my knowledge and ability, I always used to think of one thing. Lord, east or west, the presence of the Lord is most in Revival Church. But that day the Lord proved me wrong. No, my son, I am where people are hungry. I'm hungry. I don't want programs. The Lord doesn't want programs. A lot of people get into this thing called programs and they lose the presence of God and the anointing. They just want to show something. You know, we just want to perform. We just want to show off a message. All those things have been taken out of our church. Those in agreement said an amen. We are only interested in knowing the Lord. There are hungry people sitting here. They should be fed and God can do it a million ways. Number three, my experience. Now, this is not a doctrine what I'm telling you. This is only an experience. That meeting, I told you Jesus Christ's presence was so awesome. After I left, I called Pastor Suresh from the airport. He told me, Pastor, there is a fear of the Lord that has come upon the people. I said, awesome, that's great, that's what we want. But he said, there's a reason for that. A death took place. The meeting was over. I left that place by about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. A death took place by 2:30 a.m. in the morning next day. I said, it has nothing to do with my ministry because my Jesus doesn't kill people. He is a life-giving Jesus. He said, that is true. But the person who died is not a believer. The person who died was somebody who was consistently bothering one of our church members with sorcery. She was having heart problems again and again and again. She would go to the doctor. The doctor would say, there is nothing wrong with you. But she used to have palpitations. She used to have problems. She could not sleep well. She was a good prayer warrior. But she could not even go to church. The Lord released her during that meeting. That night, she went back. She found out that night, her opponent's life was taken away. I started to fear the Lord a little more. Because it is Jesus who has the right over life and death. I asked the Lord, Lord, why did you allow that? In my ministry, I do not want somebody to die. That is not something, because the new covenant ministry is not a covenant of death. It's a covenant of life. But I want to remind the church, if you would think along with me, Paul was touched by the Holy Spirit when God first met him. You don't hear of the rest of the people that were with Paul. That means to me, you and I have had the privilege of being chosen by the Lord. And he protects us. And though I don't like to say this, I'm sharing this with you to tell you how much God protects his church. Whoever touches the church, they touch the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore I say, Lord, whoever touches me or our church, please change them around to repentance. Whether it's a sorcerer or it is a evil person, we don't want anything to happen to people. I know, I probably some of you don't agree with me. I say, people do things against us or the kingdom of God in ignorance. We stand in the gap and plead for them. But in my mind, this thought keeps coming. Sometimes I do my will. You can't stop from God doing his will. People of God, let us fear and thank the Lord that he is with us. Amen. In other words, what we take today is we ask for more of God's presence, more of his works and more of his plans in our life. If we lose out, we become just another church. Just another church, and I don't want that. If you want just another church, you know, you can get just another church. For me, I don't want another church. I want a church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Also, I had the privilege of visiting Bobby's parents, wonderful people. Bobby's dad gave me a beautiful, hey, this guy Bobby, he's sitting there like that. Don't leave him like that. This guy preaches in churches. Okay, pastors. Bobby's dad, was baptized many years ago from a Matamo background. While he was being baptized, they baptized him in a river. And there was this serpent, which in Malayalam we call Pulavan. Or Pulavan, I don't know what they are. One of that. As they were baptizing him, this Kalimala Kunjumanchayan baptized his dad. A snake got in through the shirt of the pastor and started standing like this. Right, Bobby? And you know what? This pastor quickly rebuked, in Jesus' name I command you. Immediately that snake slithered away. The baptism went on very well. How do you like pastors like that? Somebody said hallelujah. It is a joy to go to his home and a couple of other places. It is a joyful thing. And thank God, because God is good. Amen. More questions you can ask me later if it will help you, strengthen you. Let us look into God's word. We have 40 minutes ahead of us. The purpose of my message today is to show you that God still transforms people. God still transforms people. By the way, I want to tell you quickly something. Church, our church is an open church. Anybody can come here. You can listen to the word of God. You can leave. There is no binding on any of you. But there are people who have been here for a long time. They consider themselves as members of the church. I consider myself as a member of the church. We don't hold anybody here for anything. But let me tell you one thing. If you ask me for advice, and if after prayer I give you an advice, I expect you to go by the advice. If after asking me that advice, you'd go and do something against what I told you, I will not be responsible for the consequences. Do we understand each other? You don't have to. You don't have to ask me for anything. You can straight away seek the Lord. You can speak to any pastor anywhere in the world. Get their counsel. You can move accordingly. This is an open church. This is a free church. I do not hold you. The Lord does not hold anybody like this. You're free. But if you want to ask me, Pastor, this is a problem we are going through. Will you pray for me? I will pray for you. And 90% I've seen the Lord giving some word. After the Lord has given you a word of advice, if you choose to disobey it, fine. I'm not offended or hurt. You can still choose to disobey if you want. That's between you and God. But don't expect me to come and stand with you in the time of consequences. Do we have an agreement? Did I make myself very clear? You can come into church. You don't have to give money. This church is not based on money. We live by faith. You can come, sit here. You don't have to subscribe to anything in the church. Come sit here, receive the word of God, freely given, freely taken. None of us will come after you for money. We won't ask you for favors, nothing. We love everybody here. Come here, listen to the word of God. If the Lord is leading you, there is a offertory box. Do good, feel good, give the money, thanking God for all the finances you are given. 4, you have problems, we are all available here to come and pray for you. And when we pray for you, the Lord may give a word. If you disobey the word of the Lord in your life, I cannot be. Pastors, if you want to be, you can be. I'm not going to control you also. If you feel you should side with people against the will of God, you can do that. If anybody feels you want to side with people when they disobey God, you can do that. I am not available. Is this very clear? Is this very clear, people of God? Those who heard it, can I see your hands lifted up? In other words, you have the freedom to do what you think is right. Nobody is stopping you. This ministry will continue. The Lord has been good to me, to us. He will take this ministry through. But if you live in disobedience and you keep on telling me, I'm not responsible for that. Wherever I've seen obedience, wherever I've seen people doing the things God has told them, I've seen immediate changes. I have seen tremendous changes. So many people are sitting here who can give you hundreds of testimonies of things God is doing. God is nobody's debtor. You obey him, things will work out fine. Amen. Hallelujah. Can we go forward? Amen. Let's go. I want to talk to you about Paul and the changes of his life, which the Holy Spirit brought in his life. I call this message the tongue of Paul. By the way, the Lord told me something which is good for us. All authority has been given to us. This was revealed to you, pastors. All authority has been given to us as a church. We have every right. Many things will happen according to what we say and pray in this nation. Amen. You will see that happening. This morning I heard that there were some people who were raising up a racist flag somewhere. I don't know the name. Please pray and bind. As you bind, it will be bound. We don't want any racism in the United States of America. United States of America is a country where all people who have been brought in here by the Lord can live. Freedom for all, equity for all, justice for all, color, creed, race has no nothing. Nobody can claim to be anything in this world. If anybody can, it is the kingdom of God and the people of God. And I tell you, the people of God, pastors and congregations throughout the length and breadth of this great country, made great by God, are praying day and night. And nobody from the Spirit of the Lord will ever give importance to any racism. Racism comes from the pits of hell. And I have no apology. I make no apology to preach it in this basement and all over the world. Racism does not come from the Spirit of God. And we continuously pray and bind. People of God, what you bind will be bound. What you release will be released. If you pray, things will open up for you. If you release and pray, things will open up for you. If you bind, also do not bind people, bind demons behind people. Amen. Am I coming in clearly, people of God? Amen. Use your authority. Use your authority. That is the greatness of the kingdom of God. Here we go. Acts 9:1-2. The first reference of Saul, a man later transformed to be Paul. I call this message the taming of the tongue of Paul. The taming of the tongue of Paul. I have found out if our tongues are tamed, a lot of problems can be taken care of. 99% of problems come because we do not know how to tame our tongue. As we are going to see how Paul could not tame his tongue and got into trouble. But later the same Paul was used by God. His tongue was used by God to bring thousands of people, millions, to the kingdom of God. Here we go. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. This, I think, is the first reference to the Apostle Paul in the Bible, written by Luke, who was with Paul the Apostle later. Luke writes about Paul, how he was breathing out threats. That simply means he was cursing and shouting against the people of God. Here is a man who was a very learned man. He was a Pharisee. And he was friends probably with a lot of religious hierarchy. And here is a man who was speaking a bad thing. He was threatening people, shouting at people. This is the first picture we have about man. Let me tell you something from my life. Yesterday my children were asking me, you may be educated outside, but inner refinement need not come from education. You may have studied in Harvard University and got a doctorate. That's a great thing too. I want to challenge all the children to do that. But that will not bring in the inner refinement. You can know a man's inner refinement the minute he opens his mouth in adversity. Hallelujah. And you see this man, you could call him Reverend Dr. Saul. He studied in the University of Gamaliel. And probably he studied in some other university too. But here was a man who was acting worse than a religious fanatic, threatening and breathing out, speaking curses against the people of God. Of course, he did it in ignorance. Hallelujah. And now we see, as we go down, Acts 9, 29 to 31, the next stage of Paul's speech that we see in the Bible, Acts 9, 29 to 31. And Paul spoke boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and disputed against the Grecians, but they went about to slay him. Look at this word carefully. This man is born again. He is speaking about Jesus Christ, but look at the result of his speech. They went about to slay him. Not because they were anti-Christians. In case you did not know, these Grecians were Greek-speaking Jews who were converted to Christianity. In other words, he was fighting with all the brothers and sisters of the church. In other words, even after being born again, Paul did not know how to use his tongue right. You see, however, that there was an addition to his spirit after being born again. He was very bold and he was full of the revelation of Jesus Christ. Without the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ, you cannot preach so powerfully against Greek people. I want to challenge this church today. I want to challenge all the young people today. Maybe you will not go to a seminary or a Bible college. It's a good thing to go if you want to go. But God can give you amazing boldness to silence the critics of the kingdom in your time, if you'll yield yourself to the Lord. At the right time, God can touch your tongue and mouth to bring out words of wisdom and grace. You see that happening here in the life of Paul. But there is a big problem here. After all the nice speaking and revelations and boldness, you see fellow Christians wanted to kill Saul. Amen. That shows a part of Paul's spiritual growth. I have a word of instruction for many of you. Many of the YouTube messages, then, especially those of you who come from Kerala, you are watching a lot of people, I want you to know, who are going through situations like that. They may be preaching the word of God, but they are far away from the kingdom of God. Because after they preach, you feel like taking your slipper and slapping them. This, I want you to know, and I want you to be encouraged, that Paul himself went through situations like that. Here was a man who was a part of the construction. He was anointed by God. He had met with Jesus. He had heard the voice of God. But the minute he began to preach, he was not bringing in healing. He was bringing in dispute, a stage which God was using Paul. We have great, great hope there. Even when we are born again, even when we are baptized, even when we say we belong to Jesus, even when we say that we love Jesus more than the world, I want you to know there are stages in our life where we may not be perfect as God wants us to be perfect. We can take an encouragement today and say, Lord, if you change Paul, you can change me too. Somebody said hallelujah. In our time, speaking is not just behind the pulpit. I want you to know, speaking is behind closed doors. A family can be safe if the husband decides to talk in kindness. Many husbands will say, I love to talk in kindness. The problem is when she starts speaking back, and then I'm not able to speak a kind word. Well, I got excellent news for you. If you can understand that every man, every woman thrives on kindness, if you continuously, consistently are kind to your wives, to your spouses, sooner or later, something good will come out of your life. Consistent kindness, consistent goodness, consistent character of the Lord Jesus Christ on our tongues makes a big difference. I want to talk to all the men of the house. The key has been given to us, not to the others. Those in agreement said an amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. All right, here we go. This is the second part which we see about Paul. Paul was just changing, or the Lord was just changing. And now we go to Acts 13:2, the next stage in Paul's life. Acts 13:2, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I have called them. Between chapter 9 and chapter 13, there are two main things that happen in Paul's life. I'm not going to take that. Number one, Paul was rejected. Thrown away. It reads after chapter 9, because he was fighting with the Greek Christians, the church decided to put him away. And then all the disciples with one accord, hired a taxi cab and said, Paul, we'll give you the return ticket we'll give you the ticket that way to Tarsus with no return ticket. Do not come back because your presence is making a lot of problems. And Paul was seated in Tarsus for probably a long time. My understanding is probably 10 or 12 years. I don't know. Finally, the Holy Spirit moved Barnabas, not even an apostle, to go and fetch Paul. He goes and picks up Paul. Paul and Barnabas goes not to Jerusalem. They go straight to Antioch. He goes straight to Antioch. And there you read, just before this part, there you read, Paul was a very, very submissive fellow. Nothing much to talk about because he learned his lesson. Even if you may be the biggest orator of the world, God is not going to use your oratorial skills. God is going to put his mouth on your mouth. So he will not give his glory to anybody's ability. So Paul had to be silenced, I would call crushed, educated. Till now he was ready. He was beginning to serve in the church of Antioch as one good believer, as a good elder. Slowly, 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 the Lord began to give him small, small jobs. One of the jobs was to take a lot of money to Jerusalem, which he fulfilled quite victoriously. The Bible says that after that, the Holy Spirit began to select him. People of God, especially young people and all of you, I want you to know, unless and until the Lord selects you, nothing is going to happen in your life. This is not a dig at anybody or a poke at anybody. I'm telling you my life. I used to compose music at a very young age. I have sang songs, and I was the only person who ever heard it. Praise God. I have this gift from my dad's side, mom's side. They're all good musicians, great people. I've heard them singing in the family prayer, and I got an extra dose of an ability to sing. But I want you to know, until the Holy Spirit touched me, those songs had no value. Until the Holy Spirit touched me, my compositions nobody knew. When the Holy Spirit takes you in his hand, you're a totally different person. Wait for that, God will change you. This is our prayer for all of you, right from the pastors, right through all of you, even the little children. Allow the Holy Spirit to select you. What a joy it is that the Holy Spirit can select you. Do these things happen today? Absolutely. Even today, the Holy Spirit is in the process of selection. People are selected by the Holy Spirit. And I got exciting news for you. Once the Holy Spirit selects you, nobody can push you down. Please understand this. Nobody. They will not dare touch you. Rather, whoever was opposing you will quietly move out. Say, sorry, it's your time to go up. Sorry, we did not know that you are the call of God. But unless the Holy Spirit touches you, there's no point. Did you get this? I want to tell a lot of you, especially in this service, this is the time to feed, receive from the Lord. Because when Paul was going to be raised up, he was a man of authority and power. The Holy Spirit was ready to use him. He was ready to be used by the Holy Spirit. I want to tell many of you sitting here, please wait on the Holy Spirit. Receive from the Holy Spirit. Let the experiences of your life bring you victory as you are in this church. Let the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit begin to change you to be men and women who can change the world upside down. And somebody said hallelujah. I have a word there quickly. A quick word for somebody here. Every moment that you wait, the Lord says, is not in vain. I will make up for the time you think you are losing. Do I hear an amen? Let's go forward. Hallelujah. So you see, a selection or an election and a selection and an appointment comes from the Holy Ghost himself, who says, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work where I have called them. Paul is now ready. Saul is ready along with Barnabas. Just a quick word. Did you see how the Holy Spirit called them? Who has more experiences in seeing the Lord? Barnabas or Saul? Saul. But look at the order in which God is calling Barnabas and Saul. Barnabas and Saul, not Saul and Barnabas. Why? I want you to know something. Why? Because it was Barnabas who was first used by the Lord to get Saul into the kingdom. Therefore, God was honoring Barnabas. I have a word for many of you. You do not know who you are going to bring into the church tomorrow. You may be bringing a Paul. You may be bringing some great man, mighty man of God. But remember, God will honor you. Never, never forget that. Children, today many of them think that, you know, the limelight is the ultimate. It is not. Don't learn that the hard way. Limelight is nothing. There is something deeper than limelight. Never forget the people who prayed for you. Never forget the people who stood by you in your times of trouble. Barney, as I call him, old Barney, was the best friend of Paul when he went through the toughest times of his life. Paul went through rejection. There was a Barnabas to stay. Paul, don't give up. The apostles rejected him. Paul, don't give up. I'll pray for you. There was a Barnabas for Paul. The Holy Spirit is acknowledging Barnabas. I have so many Barnabases in my life. And as the Lord leads, I too am a Barnabas for many people. Remember, God honors that Barnabas. Be a Barnabas in somebody's life. Somebody may be crying. Somebody may be in tears. You are a church. You have a pastoral authority. Go and speak to somebody. I don't want to mention names. The other day, somebody was telling me, though that person was a little out of the ordinary, he was telling me, Pastor, when I was going through the toughest time of my life, somebody in the church came to me, sat with me and prayed throughout. I said, I'm encouraged. I wrote a text to that person and said, I said, thank you for praying for that person. That person needed it a lot. Don't wait for a pastoral authority before you become a Barnabas. You don't need the pulpit to become a Barnabas. Christ is with you. Go and live someone else at the right time. When their names are written, your names will also be written. Hallelujah. Church, never, never, never forget. The least that you do in the kingdom of God will go unrecorded. Oh my God. I want to go back to Muwatipura. Hallelujah. Nothing, anything that you do in the kingdom of God, He takes a note of it. He will reward you. Nothing that you do, even a glass of water, will not go without a reward. We are not speaking this for a glass of water or to advertise a reward. Just to encourage you. The things that you do in private, probably praying for somebody, speaking to somebody on the telephone, you think nobody is acknowledging me. That is what you think. Somebody is writing all these things down. At the right time, a big gate of heaven will be open for you. He knows. He knows. He knows. He knows. He is God. He is good. His name is, He's the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Never forget that. Never, never forget that. Hallelujah. He's a good God. Yesterday, in tune with what I am telling you, I was listening to the first generation of the first, the Pentecostal crowd, the early Pentecostal crowd of Kerala. I happened to be with a lot of them yesterday. And this lady was actually, there was a wedding going on. And the lady stood up and she acknowledged one thing. She said, many years ago, when my great-grandfather and my husband's great-grandfather wanted to go to Sweden to preach the word of God, we did not have any money. And then some family said, you can mortgage our property to the bank, take the money for visa and passport and go to Sweden and preach the word of God. Yesterday's wedding was between the fourth generation of these two families. She said, when somebody signed a mortgage not to buy another house, you don't know what is going to happen. You're going to give the money for somebody's visa and passport. No returns. Somebody took a note of it in heaven. Four generations later, the Lord said, these two are good to be together. I have ordered this marriage. That is the way our God works. He will never forget. A glass of water you give to the kingdom of God will never go unseen. He is nobody's rewarder. Nobody's debtor. He's a rewarder. Whatever you do, even the slightest thing, saints, be strengthened. The Lord is strengthening me according to that word. Let me tell you, in your times of trial, I know you're all good people. I know where we all come from. So it may be difficult for me to say this word. But sometimes remember, In the time of a problem of a man of God, probably you wrote a check for $20. Do you know that will be working for you at that time of need? I'm not asking for money. Somebody, my daughters were upset with me because week before last I asked for some money. They said, "Dad, what happened to you? What came over you? You're asking for money in the church." I said, "It's not for money. I didn't ask for money for myself, which God knows and I know. And I have the right to ask for money, which I don't misuse. That's all." Amen. If you gave, oh, let us forget money because we seem to get upset about money. Let us say you gave a glass of water to some man of God somewhere and he accepted it and said, "Ah, my thirst has been quenched." That simple sigh of satisfaction goes to heaven, gets recorded in your name. Probably you don't need it, but your generations may need it. The Lord will remember it. At the right time, he will give it to you. Do I know it? Does my sister know it? Millions of times. Hallelujah. He is nobody's debtor. Amen. Small thing. The Lord said, "If you do unto these little ones, you are doing it unto me." You go to the jail, you are doing it to me. You clothe the poor, you are doing it to me. Church, I have a wake-up call for you. Get ready to do good works. I'm so happy when both the pastors agree with that vision. I thank God for these wonderful men. Not sugi picking them. That's the way Malayali people look at it. When something is good, we are for good works. Because the Lord tells us to do good works. There are people, homeless people in Philadelphia. There is a homeless pastor in Thiruvalla, Kerala. We are trusting in the Lord. We are going to build a house for him. Are you with me? No. We will not come to your houses with a receipt folder. No. The Lord, because the Lord said it, he will also give us a provision. The cattle on 1,000 hill belongs to my heavenly Father. And yours too. Learn to do good works. We have. Let us be kind to the poor. I want our children. It's been my desire for the last 4 or 5 years to take our children to places where they have orphanages, where they have, at least this year we want to make it happen. Parents, take a note of it and let us know when we can all meet and take our children to see orphanages and how people live without family. We are blessed. Let our blessings flow into the dry lands. Amen. Not because we want something, but because we already have Christ. We are not doing good works to go to heaven. Church, is the theology clear? No good works will take us to heaven. But because we will go to heaven, because our heavenly Father has already said yes, because he is with us, we are going to do a lot of good works. Those in agreement can say an amen to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Remember, I told you about 6 months ago, I said, I'm so much into a project, and that project has a lot to do with feeding a lot of people. Amen? Hallelujah. So here you see, Barnabas is being mentioned just before Paul, just because the Lord had decided to Barnabas, though God chose Paul to be a great man of God eventually, and we don't hear much of Barnabas. We see that God is honoring Barnabas. Thank God for all the Barnabases in life. Let's go to Acts 13:7 and see the next point of elevation in the life of Paul. Acts 13:7. Good. You're improving. Who was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man, look at this, who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. I love this. Here is a man who we may call a Gentile. He is calling Paul and Barnabas. Barnabas and Paul. Why? Not to question them about their faith. They wanted to hear the words that were coming out of these two wonderful men. Look at the transformation in Paul's life. There was a time people wanted to kill him and throw him out of the church. Now that is over. The transformation in Paul's life is wanting people to come to them and say, "Come preach the word of God to us. Come preach the word of God." How many of you like to listen to that level? You know why Paul was acknowledged there? God having seen, this is not written in the scriptures, I am telling you, God having seen the changes in Paul's life was attesting Paul to different ministries. Church, here is a word of advice, word of wisdom. What is inside is what will come out. If I stand here and put on a show, let me see, if I try to imitate Benny Hinn, you will get Benny Hinn probably. If I'm a good actor, you may get Benny Hinn, but you won't get Christ. If I stand here in all the humility and say, Lord, this is what I am, use me, you will get Christ. That is our calling. Paul was like that. He was changing. And now people wanted to hear what he had to say. Look at the transformation in Paul's life. Aren't you happy to see that? Let's keep reading. Acts 13, 1 to 12, you see, we want to read through the whole message. Those who, we're not going to do that. The whole message, I would like you to go home and read that. Just 44 verses. Okay, we have time. Let us read through quickly. There were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. Verse 2, I am reading through. If you will, just focus and receive. The Holy Spirit will speak to you directly. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. We went through that. When they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Verse 4. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. And when they were at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogue of the Jews. And they also had John, that is John Mark, who wrote the fourth gospel, to their minister. Verse 6, and when they had gone through the island unto Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus, meaning son of Jesus. Okay, verse 7, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man, who called for Barnabas and Saul, and desired to hear the word of God. That is where we just touched. Let's move on. But Elymas the sorcerer withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. People do that even today. When you speak the word of God, pray for people near them and bind those spirits, because there are stronger Elymases today. By the way, this morning, a thought came to me, church, just to get your attention. If you thought that the times and the anointing of Paul and Peter was the ultimate, I have news for you. We need a greater anointing these days. The evil in the world is more than it was in the first century. We need greater anointing. Do not let Paul or Peter stand as a ceiling for your growth. If they were used in their times, we can be used in our times. What we need is the anointing and the word and the confidence that Christ is with us. But Elymas the sorcerer withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. Then Saul, filled with the Holy Ghost, wow, I like this, set his eyes on him. Go on. And said, O full of all subtlety and all mischief, you child of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? I wouldn't say this. Probably from today I will. I don't think Paul was being mature here as a Christian. See what happens immediately. Verse 11. And now behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee. You shall be blind, not seeing the sun for us. That's a curse. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. That demon-possessed man, trying to stop the gospel, was struck by this man's word. So powerful was the anointing and the word that was given to Paul. Are there people like that today? Yes. Never stand against God's word. You like it, you don't like it. The word of God is very powerful. By the way, church, I want to tell you something. The word of God has been so diluted today. You know, people just like a feel-good factor. Nice feelings. And pastor, you spoke in grace means the pastors didn't speak anything against sin and things like that. Let me tell you, the gospel is slightly greater than that. It is not something we play around with. It is fire. God wants you to have that fire in your mouths, so that when you speak, good things may happen. That's my desire. But even today you heard. I don't think Paul wanted to do this, but this man had it coming. And here we go. Go to, okay, let's, okay. Then the deputy, when he saw, verse 12. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. A lot of things learned there. We'll go forward. 13. The Lord is not letting me go. Go back to 12. A quick word that those of you who are talking about doctrine, they all saw this as a doctrine. That means when Paul spoke, he also confirmed it with signs. This is a sign. Many of you wonder about signs and wonders. Today, most people think of signs and wonders as miracles, healing miracles. I want you to know there are signs and wonders, not just healing miracles. This is a sign. Because of this sign, you see later on somebody is believing. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. Church, I want you to pray that the Lord will entrust us with this kind of a doctrine. When after we speak, people will know by the sign that it is the Lord himself. And those who said it, and an agreement said it. It is going to happen in this church. Your church, beautiful church. Amen. Let's move forward. Okay. Now when Paul and his company loosed from Paphos, they came to Perga in Pamphylia. And John departing from them, this was a problem. John departing from them returned to Jerusalem. Probably John got upset at the way Paul spoke. We don't know. Verse 14. But when they departed from Perga, they came to Antioch in Pisidia and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and sat down. Verse 15. And after the reading of the law, that's a Mosaic law, and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent unto them saying, you men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. It was an open synagogue. Even during the time of Moses, it was an open synagogue. Anybody could talk. Hallelujah. Okay, verse 16, look at Paul. Then Paul stood up and beckoning with his hand said, men of Israel and you that fear God, listen to me. Give audience. Okay. The God of this people of Israel chose our fathers and exalted the people when they dwelt as strangers in the land of Egypt, and with a high arm brought he out of them, out of it. 18. And about a time of 40 years, see, suffered he their manners in the wilderness. Verse 19. And when he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he divided their land to them by lot. Verse 20. And after that he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years until Samuel the prophet. By the way, I know you can all read the scriptures, but I'm reading to you to make you understand something. So hold on, hang on, stay with me. And after that he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years until Samuel the prophet. Verse 21. Afterward they desired a king, and God gave unto them Saul, the son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, by the space of 40 years. Again 40 years. Verse 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave that testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. Verse 23. Of this man's seed has God, according to his promise, raised unto Israel a Savior, Jesus. Verse 24. When John had first preached before his coming the baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. Verse 25. And as John fulfilled his course, he said, who do you think that I am? I am not he, but behold, there comes one after me, whose shoes of his feet I am not worthy to loose. Verse 26. Men and brothers, children of the stock of Abraham, and whosoever among you feareth God, to you is the word of this salvation sent. Acts 27, verse 27. For they that dwell at Jerusalem, their rulers, because they knew him not, nor yet the voices of the prophets which are read every Sabbath day, they have fulfilled them in condemning them. Verse 28. And though they found no cause of death in him, yet decide they Pilate that he should be slain. Verse 29. And when they had fulfilled all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree, that is the cross, laid him in a sepulcher. Verse 30. But God raised him from the dead. Verse 31. And he was seen many days of them which came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses unto the people. Verse 32. And we declare unto you glad tidings, how that the promise which was made unto the fathers, verse 33, God has fulfilled the same unto us their children, in that he has raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in Psalms 2, you are my son, this day have I begotten you. Keep going. And as concerning that he raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption. He said on this wise, I'll give you the sure mercies of David. That is for the church, the sure mercies of David. Wherefore, he also said in another psalm, you shall not allow your Holy One to see corruption. Verse 36. For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid unto his fathers and saw corruption. Verse 37. But he, that is Jesus, who God raised again, saw no corruption. Verse 38. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. Verse 39. And by him all that believed. I want the church to know this. Especially some of you are asking me about righteousness. All that believe him are justified from all things. You are justified from all things. From which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. What the law of Moses cannot justify, what your conscience cannot justify, Jesus Christ and his gospel can justify. Let's go down. Okay. Beware therefore lest eat that come upon you which is spoken of in the prophets. Verse 41. Behold, you despise us. He keeps speaking to them directly now, not to us. Verse 42. Now, when the Jews, listen to this. When the Jewish people had gone out of the synagogue, you know why they went out of the synagogue? Because the Holy Spirit was again touching their conscience. Paul was now preaching spiritually. He was speaking right from the beginning to what Jesus Christ was doing. Why was he doing it? I told you, I wanted to tell you why I was reading the whole thing. In his message, he was speaking out the wonders of the Lord, the works of the Lord. The same thing the apostles did when the Holy Spirit came upon them. I want all of you to know, when you preach God's word, speak the works of the Lord. When he preached the work of the Lord, the Jews were condemned. They began to leave. But the Gentiles stayed back. The Gentiles besought that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Look at that. Look at the transformation in the way Paul's mouth, Paul's tongue, and Paul's ministry is changing. Even when some people said, this fellow is hopeless, he does not know how to speak, only thing he knows is to touch and poke and prick us. There was a group of people who came back and said, Paul, we loved the word of God that you were preaching. We want you to come back the next week and we want you to speak to us. That is the kind of transformation God can give to his people. Let's go to verse 43. Now when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jewish and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas. Look at this. It is now Paul and Barnabas. You know why? 1 Corinthians 15:10. Go back home and learn it. We'll tell you why. Church, I have a word for you. If you choose, you can become number one in the presence of God. You are not second. God did not see you as secondary or second to anyone. It is your choice. Though Paul started as the least, he ended up right on top. That's God's desire for you. Don't forget this. A lot depends on how you take it. Okay, let's go to the next thing. The next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together. When the Jews went away, church, pastors pray, whoever was blocking Paul, standing against Paul, God just lifted them and threw them out. Now the whole city is coming to hear the word of God. You see the justice of God? Paul was a good preacher. But the Jewish people did not acknowledge him. Who are you to tell us about our forefathers? Who made you a preacher? We know you. You're a miserable fellow. When were you born again? Paul stood his ground and kept preaching. Who changed? God kept on changing. Paul? God removed the block. Somebody said hallelujah. The whole city came in. Do you see that, people? That is the kind of transformation our Lord does. Okay, the next Sabbath day came the whole congregation to hear the word of God. And now we have problem. Verse 45. When the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with God was calling the entire nations and saying, Jesus Christ, my son, he has been given to you. Accept him and come to heaven. But the Jewish people would not like it. They were filled with, we are filled with the Holy Spirit. Other people are filled with. This is the same thing that took Jesus to the cross, not theology. I want the church to know today, lot of young people are kept. God has kept them. God is raising a lot of young people. There are many young people in our church also. God is keeping them on the anvil at the right time. They are coming. Parents, we are praying. Pray. This will not affect our children. Lot of young people today serving the Lord so powerfully. They will come and preach a word or lead worship. It is so beautiful. Somebody with this attitude will come and start killing them. Turn to your neighbor and say, this church will always stand with the growth of servants of God and children of God. We shall not be filled with envy. We shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. That is our calling. Yep, I got 5 more minutes. I asked you time till 1. Yesterday I was speaking to a young man. And more than the young man, his wife told me, China's got an IPC ordination. I said, wonderful, praise the Lord. She's only probably 30 and her Achayan was only 36. I set him aside. I said, son, many people come to America. They land in the wrong place. I said, son, don't do that. You're young. You have an entire life in front of you. Serve the Lord wholeheartedly. Do not compromise before the dollar. Do not compromise for the position. Stand with Jesus. You know what he did? He came and gave me a hug. Very, very, I was surprised. I never expected a hug from. But God is telling me how to love Pentecostals too. Praise God. That is a change. My life is also changing. He just came and hugged me. Gave me a kiss on either cheek. I said, son, you're young. You have years to go. Do not let people destroy your ministry. Stand for Jesus without compromise. Let us build young lives. When somebody does something better than us, when somebody is filled with the Holy Spirit, how many of you are genuinely happy? Well, somebody is filled with the demonic spirit, we know how to handle that. When somebody is filled with Holy Spirit, we stand back and say, Lord, we see your work. Thank you for raising up that young man. Thank you for raising up that young woman. Thank you. We are seeing your work. Amen. Let's go to verse 46. We're going to land soon. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold. Now look at this guy. Look at the way he speaks with authority. It was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you. But seeing you put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we are going to the Gentiles. A man who stood against the gospel of Jesus Christ, touched by the Lord. Many people say immediately Paul was changed. Wrong. Today I hope the Holy Spirit has showed you, even Paul, it was days and days and days of becoming the perfect vessel of God. Did you understand that we all go through this? You don't become a good minister overnight. You don't become a good speaker overnight. You can't expect to feed millions of people. Today, a lot of young people decide, what do you want to do? Serve millions. Start serving one. You will serve millions. 2018, God willing, October, I'll be preaching to a crowd of 4,000 people in Punjab. And I want to take my young brothers and sisters with me. I didn't want to break it out. I think Pastor Joseph already has spoken this to you. Pray that we'll be able to go as a team. We're going. That's just if you want to send your children to Punjab in India. Praise God. There are going to be thousands of people there. And I'm praying that our children will be able to do something at least on a day. Lead worship. Do something. Hallelujah. Not to expose our children or to show off, but that God's name may be lifted up. Amen. Remember, we all are in the process. God did not fail in Paul's life. God did not fail in Barnabas' life. God will not fail in your life. Unless you tell the Lord, Lord, take off. I don't want anything to do with you. He's so good, he doesn't force you to go that extra mile. But today, I want to encourage you. If you will, yield to him and say, Lord, make something out of my life. Something good out of my life. Who's on the keyboard today? Get back to the keyboard quickly. If you will make a commitment today, church. I gave you in the Holy Spirit. I gave you examples. I gave you examples of being a Barnabas. I gave you example of the transformation power of the Holy Spirit upon your tongue. And I gave you so many words that the Lord told me. Change your life. Give your tongues to the Lord today. Let the rivers of living water flow through your tongues. Tell the Lord today. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, use my tongue and my heart. When you make a commitment, I want you to stand if you will. Make a commitment and say, Lord, use my mouth and my tongue. Bring the transformation, Lord, through my mouth. Who will give their lives to Jesus today? Lord, make me a Barnabas. Make me somebody who can be used. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Let the Spirit lead you. My job is to keep on encouraging people. But it is the Holy Spirit who has to make you to stand up, not me. If you will hand over your tongue, as I said in the beginning, the way we manage our tongues determines how happy we can be, how we can keep ourselves away from problems, foolishness, folly, the way we talk to people, the way we handle ourselves, all that depends on the tongue. If you'll give your tongues to the Lord, a humble tongue. This is what I pray for our church today, a humble tongue. A tongue that can be used by the Lord. Tongues that can be prepared by the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. As you open your mouth and speak out your commitment to the Lord, may He fill you with rivers of living water. It is not Paul's decision that changed him. It was a call of his life. As he continuously yielded his life to that call, the Holy Spirit continuously began to use his circumstance. He sent difficult people across his way. But in all these things, Paul was victorious. We also are called to be victorious in all things. If you will open your mouth and start thanking the Lord. You're the living water, never drying fountain, comforter and counselor, take complete control. You're the living water, never drying fountain, comforter and counselor. Use my tongue, Lord. Give your tongue to the Lord in a special way, people. Lord, use my tongue. Lord, heal it of all kinds of dirt, sting, talking back. Please heal my tongue from the flesh. Come on, pray like that. With your power. I don't want to speak filth. I want to speak my Jesus words. Those of you who have been gifted to speak in tongues, I hear a voice telling me that the Lord is a bit upset with some of you. After having received the gift, you do not use it. The Lord has given you that gift to be used. There are many who are desirous for that gift. You have the gift, you're not using it. Why don't you open your mouth and use it? Ask the Lord to give you ability to speak in tongues. He can make you to speak in tongues. Tongues is the tongue of the Lord activated on your tongue in the spirit. Come on. Welcome, Holy Spirit.
Welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence. Fill us with your power.
As a whole church, we commit our tongue, our speeches, our reactions, everything into your hands. Lord, heal us. Heal our hearts and minds. Heal our tongue. Teach us to use our tongue right, that it may bring edification to our hearers, not only on the pulpit, but in our daily life, that we may always speak encouraging words, always comforting words. Lord, we stand in the gap and ask you forgiveness for words of anger, hatred, different kinds of words that come to us. From today, Lord, let not the flesh have dominion over our tongue, but the Spirit of the Lord, that our tongues may be used as powerful weapons to destroy the works of the enemy, to speak new life into those who listen to us, new life in the circumstances, that we may use our tongues as powerful weapons, instruments of joy, instruments that the Holy Spirit can use, that we may declare words and power. Somebody here, do not give a lot of importance to your work. Let me go a little slow. It is not your work that is feeding you. It is the Lord that is feeding you. If you forget the Lord and run after your work, whoever you are, because the Lord loves you so much, He will get your attention back to Him. I'm seeing a lot of that happening in the church now. People are very busy with their work. It is good. Come up, be the first number one in your work. But remember, it is the Lord. It is the Lord who gave you the ability to work. It is the Lord who gave you the health to work. He is the one who is satisfying you. Don't be carried away with your work. If your work is taking away your quiet time, if your work is taking away your sleep, the Lord is not happy about it. Tell the Lord, Lord, you made me to work. Enjoy your work. Enjoy your work. Spend time with your family. Take time to sit with your children. Pray with them. Because the Lord is your provider. If there are workaholics in this church this morning, please know, workaholism in the presence of God is just like alcoholism. He hates it. You are not called to be a workaholic. You are called to be a vessel of the Lord. This morning, if you will allow me, along with the pastors and the rest of the church, we're going to break every workaholism in this church. It is the Lord who provides. It is the Lord who provides. It is the Lord who provides. Psalms 127 and 128. Unless the Lord builds the house, they that build the house labors in vain. Let there be a blessing for your labor, people of God. Let there be a blessing for your labor. If you want the Lord to bless your labor, commit your works.
commit your life to the Lord right now. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we commit the works of the hands of these wonderful people, our entire church, that we may not become workaholics, but we may seek your face all the time. Lord, you first, our families, the ministries that you have given to us, the work of our hands, which you have given to us, let it all fall in tune, align under the Holy Ghost. We give you all the glory. There are people here sleepless. Today we speak sleep over them. Rest over them. Yes, in Jesus' name. Rest over their souls. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen. God bless you all. Please be seated.